Very good afternoon, sir. Today we are gathered here for the webinar on impact of COVID-19 pandemic in clinical trials, consideration and tools. COVID-19, which is said to have emerged from Wuhan in China, has caused a serious impact on almost every society on the earth. Due to the problems caused by this particular health crisis all over the World Health Organization, WHO, declared it as a global pandemic. Because of its rampant spread across the countries were forced to stop international traveling as well as locked up themselves. Also, the lockdown has been recognized as the only method to control the spread of the pandemic, and almost every country has adopted this method. Amidst the lockdown in Indian society, multiple issues related to social, educational, economical, political, agricultural, psychological levels, and many more have been noticed, which has created a devastating impact on the lives of the people. Today, we will be addressing one such affected domain of clinical trials. I would like to take this opportunity on behalf of the Institute of Pharmacy, Sri Ram Swarup Memorial University, and welcome our chief guest, Mr. Sushant Sharma, who is the Assistant Drug Controller of India, functioning under the Government of India. We are grateful for him to accept our invitation and become the chief guest for today's event. Our chief guest does not require an introduction, as he is a very well recognized figure in our country. He completed his B.Pharm in 2004, after which he worked in Brooks Pharmaceuticals, Mohali, Punjab from 2004 to 2006. He then worked in Brooks Laboratories, Baddi from 2006 to 2008. In January 2009, he joined CDSCO as drug inspector and was selected as the youngest drug inspector in the batch of 14 candidates. He has an experience of approximately 400 different inspections and raids and has filed many cases against the accused. After meticulously working for 6 years as the assistant drug controller, he was promoted as the youngest assistant drug controller grade 1. He was also selected as a team member during NRA assessment of Sri Lanka and Bangladesh by the World Health Organization in Geneva. He then completed his master's in biochemistry in 2019 and is presently working as an assistant drugs controller, grade 1, and is posted at Baddi in Himachal Pradesh. We are so honored to have him as a chief guest for this webinar. I am certain that everyone present here is so thrilled and motivated to be like him. We welcome you, sir. I also extend a heartfelt welcome to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Pro Vice Chancellor, ma'am, Registrar, sir, respected deans and directors of all the other departments, and would like to thank them for gracing this occasion. I also welcome the Director of Institute of Pharmacy, Sri Ram Swarup Memorial University, to have taken this initiative and made such a remarkable webinar possible. I would also like to welcome all our faculty members, staff and students present here. Without further ado, I would like to request Dr. Professor Manju Pandey, ma'am, to say a few words of encouragement, and please welcome the dignitaries.
Good afternoon, Sushant, and good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. A warm welcome to all of you. It is an honor to have Mr. Sushant Sharma with us today, and we are privileged to have an opportunity to listen to you, sir. And we are grateful to him for accepting our invitation humbly and gladly to become chief guest and speaker of this webinar. On behalf of all gathered here, I welcome you, sir, to this webinar. Now I am requesting to Sara, please proceed further.
Thank you, ma'am, for such kind words of welcome. I would now like to request Sushant, sir, to please say a few words and grace this occasion with his presence.
Thank you so much for the nice introduction. I don't know whether it is deserving for me or not, but it is very good and I'm happy to listen this type of introduction. Thank you so much. Even first of all, I just want to thank you all the faculty members, Vice Chancellor sir, and Dr. Manju to giving this opportunity to speak something about the department, about the working of the department in this platform with a budding pharmacist and the young and enthusiastic people over here. So you were talking about the opportunity of this presentation, but I am taking this opportunity to say something to all these young people. And you know, you are the future of the country, all these young people. So take this opportunity as this seminar, take this as an opportunity to ask as much as question about your career itself, about the department, about the regulatory department, about the pandemic, so that you can clear all the doubts in your minds and all the, you know, issues related to the COVID-19, about the drugs, issues related to the vaccines, whatever you want to ask, you can ask me as much as you can. I'm here for you only and for clearing all the doubts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such kind words. Now, I would like to request you to please continue with your presentation so that we can be heard. Thank you, sir.
Sure. So I have a small presentation of 30-35 slides to giving the introduction about the department and giving the introduction about the clinical trial rule with respect to the industrial perspective as well as with respect to the academic perspective. As I know that there is a student attached in this seminar and also a faculty member. So they will got the information about the department as well as the clinical trial. I'm not going in the detail about the department because it will be the lit boring for the students attached over here. I just want to make this presentation just to give the introduction and the knowledge about what the regulatory system of India and what they are doing at this stage. So I'm just going to share my presentation if you allow that.
Yes, please.
All these students over there and the faculty member, you know, there is one regulatory system in India who is taking care of licensing activity in India, giving the permission, giving the, you know, licenses, different type of the licenses and enforcement activity like taking the samples and testing the samples, testing for the quality of the drugs. And if there is a not offended quality of the drug, so we have the penalty provisions in our regulatory system. So my slide contains basically a three parts. Part A, which is about the introduction of the Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 and 45 rules 45 made thereunder, organization and the health infrastructure in India, introduction to Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, and the Part B contains introduction to SLA and CLAs. SLA is basically a state licensing authority and CLA is a central licensing approving authority. Regulatory structure in India, regulatory provisions, and part C, I will just give the glimpse of the new clinical trial with respect to the industrial perspective as well as to the academic perspective. So I'll start with the first slide. So what is the Drug and Cosmetic Act and rule? Basically, it's a statutory provisions which is laid down in by the Honorable Parliament. Rules were made in 45, but which is amended time to time as per the committee decide about the amendment of the rules or inclusion of the new rules. So Act divided in the 6 chapter and 2 schedule. The rules are divided in the different part. And in recently, it is an introduction of the new rules. That's a new drug clinical trial rules in 19 March 2019. So what about chapters? Chapters 1 have introductory part. Chapter 2, there is the, about the Drug Technical Advisory Board and drug laboratories. Information about the drug laboratory. There is a different central drug laboratory in different states where we are sending a samples for the testing. Then there is a drug consultative committee who giving the advice to the Drug Technical Advisory Board. Chapter 3 is about the import of the drug and cosmetic. Recently, you have listened that the Sputnik came to the market and it is imported from the Russia. So the rules which they have followed in Chapter 3, it is written. Chapter 4, it's about the manufacturing, sale and distribution of the drug and cosmetic. If you are the manufacturer and want to take the license to manufacture and sale of the drug, it is mentioned in the chapter 4A. It's a provision related to the Ayurveda, Siddha and Yunani drugs. It's a Ayush basically. Chapter 5 is a miscellaneous provisions and other issues related to the drugs. So what is the organization of and health infrastructure in India? So based on federal nature, if you know that these, one is a state list, second is a central list, and third is a concurrent list. So basically, there is a drugs which is placed in the concurrent list. Means the state government is having own powers on the drug, and the central government is having own power of the drugs. So there is a Indian regulatory system for permission of a one new entity. So much of ministries involved in giving the permission. Not only the health ministry, but the different ministries are also there for the drug in provisions into the market and the drugs approval into the market. So if we talk about the one by one about the whole ministries, that Ministry of Health and Welfare, there is a DGHS, Director General of Health Services, who control the Central Drug Standard Control Organization. Central Drug Control Organization is the central licensing authority. So there is a Ministry of Science and Technology. There are ICMR. Everybody has heard about the ICMR in this pandemic situation, who is giving the list of the drug to be used in the COVID-19 and other parameters, and the pandemic is decided by the ICMR only. Then there is a BRAC for radioactive technology. BRAC is come into the picture, the Council of the Research in the scientific and the industrial research. If there is any clinical trial and research activity, so these departments come into the picture, and all the clinical trial information should be entered and uploaded into that particular department. Ministry of the Chemical and Petrochemical, it's an NPPA, and Department of Chemical Pharmaceutical and Department of Pharmaceutical. These departments basically control the pricing of the drugs. You have seen or you have heard also there is a market capping of masks, sanitizers, and different product related to the COVID-19. So the Ministry of Chemical and Petrochemicals and these departments under the ministry is taking care of the price control of the drug. Ministry of Commerce and Industry, so there is a patent officer, patent offices, Department of Commerce for the export, DGFT, Director General of Foreign Trade. This is also if anybody want to import a drug without a license for export purpose only, then DGFT is giving the permission. It's a quantity based permission. Then Controller of General of Patent. Then Ministry of the Environment and Forest. This is basically for the biotechnology products or RDNA based products. If anybody going to take want to manufacture the RDNA product, then they need the clearance from the Ministry of Environmental and Forest also. So they have the Genetic Engineering Approval Committee. There is a different committees and Department of Biotechnology, RDNA Advisory Committee, and Review Committee of Genetic Manipulation. So you need to take the approvals or clearance from this ministry, then come to the CDSU for the licensing activity. So another slide is related to the introduction of the Ministry of Health. And earlier slide, I have already informed that the CDSCO is a separate department in the Director General under the Director General of Health Services, and CDSCO is headed by the DCGI, Drug Controller General of India, and it is taking care of quality, safety, and efficacy of the drug. So we have only the relation with the issuing of the licensing and taking care of the quality, safety, and efficacy of the drug. So we have a different geographical location of CDSU. If you see that there is an office in Jammu and Kashmir, Baddi, Himachal Pradesh, headquarters in New Delhi, and then in Madhya Pradesh, MP, Ahmedabad, Goa, Bengaluru, and Chennai, Hyderabad, and Kolkata. So recently there is one of Guwahati also, Assam, and we have two zonal offices. That is a new zonal office, that is Ahmedabad and Hyderabad. And six subzonal office, and then different court offices, that is a 13, and these court offices are notified under the gazette, and that notified court offices only can allow for the import and export of the drug. And then there is a six different laboratories where we can test the quality of the drug. So this is basically introduction about the department. Now part B is the introduction of the regulatory system of the India. So you know that you all people are doing the bee farm over here. You should know about the regulatory system. So it's a very complex regulatory system, and British India. So basically, there is a two-tier system, because in previously we know that there is a provinces in India rather than states. So British has made this act and rule like the province can they do their own work, and then the different states, they can do their own work. So there is a two-tier system. There is a central licensing authority and the state licensing authority. central licensing authority is purely working under the central government, and state licensing authority purely working under the state government of their respective state. You heard about the Minister of Health in center also, the Ministry of Health in state also. So how we differentiate? Because if there is a true authority, then there must be the overlapping of the work, and there must be a clashes of the work. So to avoid the clashes, we have differentiated our work. How we have differentiated? In this slide, I have just explained that the function of CDSU. What are the function of this CDSU? Approve of the new drug and clinical trials. Means if there is any new drugs coming to the India or new entity, new molecule is coming to the India, so CDSU first giving the approval. And clinical trial permission is given by the CDSU only. Then import registration and the licensing for the drug, if going to be import into the India, so there is a work of CDSU. Licensing approval of some items like blood banks, vaccines, rDNA products, and medical devices. In medical devices, there is a different categories. So in category C and D, medical devices taken care by the CDSU. Testing of new drugs and enforcement activity. So if you see the first block, there is approval of new drug. For approval of the new drug, the CDSU is sending a sample to the different laboratories. So testing of new drug is taken care by the CDSU. Grant of test license for personal use. For personal use means if the drug is not available in India and somebody want to import the drug from outside the India for their personal use, quantity based. So CDSU is giving the license. Licenses and NOCs under the CT rules means for the test licenses, if the drug is going to be manufactured for the test examination analysis only. For example, if I am going to launch a new drug, and for launching a new drug, new molecule, new drug, you must prepare some test batches to just see the validation of the product. So the CDSU is giving the license for the test batches. Banning of drug and cosmetics. So this power is taken care by the central government. If there is a drug banned, for example, in I remember that gatifloxacin in July 2016, the gatifloxacin tablet was banned. It is what by the CDSU only. And if you heard about the new combinations which was available in the market previously, and 249 combination was banned by the CDSU in recent years, 2 to 3 years back. So amendment in Drug and Cosmetic Act and rule, if there is any amendment in rules and regulations, then only the CDSU is taking care of that amendment. So these are the function of the state authority. License of manufacturing of drugs, including the API, all the drug manufacturer who is going to manufacture the license in particular state. So they just apply the application to the state licensing authority. They are giving the licenses to manufacture the drug. License to establishment for sale and distribution, for wholesale and retail, state is giving the license. Public testing laboratory, state is giving the license. Quality of the drug and cosmetic marketed in the country, monitored. For example, if the drug is available in the market, so the drug inspector from the state can take the samples and send the sample to the laboratory for the analysis. However, this is also taken care by the CDSU nowadays. Investigation, prosecution with respect to the contravention of the legal provision. This is a common work now, state as well as a central. Recall of the substandard drug. So all the licensing authority of the state are responsible for the recall of the drug. So if you see the regulatory provision of India, so there are the licenses, there are the inspections. After an inspection, there is the issuing of the licenses. And after any contravention, there is a penalty provisions also. So these all three provisions are overlapping with each other. So what are the type of the license? So license for the manufacturer of sale of the drug, license for the stock and distribution and sale of the drug, for examination test and analysis, for private testing laboratory, of clinical trials, for import, for sale and distribution, and for import for examination and test analysis. For example, if I just want to explain this, because it's a little bit confusion. First license is related to the manufacture of the drug only. If any manufacturing unit is want to take the license, so it comes under the first category. Then the wholesale and retail premises, stock and sale distribution is wholesale and retail premises. Examination, test and analysis means for the starting of any firm, they want to take the test licenses for some validation procedures or establishment of some parameters, so they come into the examination test services. For private testing laboratory means some manufacturers does not have all the equipment of all the tests. For example, if the manufacturing is having a HPLC but does not have any other equipment like AAS, atomic absorption, and if the pharmacopoeia permit of that particular for that particular drug, that AAS should be tested in AAS, so they can take the help of the other lab which is available in the market, so which need to take the licenses as a public testing laboratory. Manufacture for clinical trial, if the drug is going to be used in clinical trial, so that must be manufactured in somewhere. So that for that particular drug, there is no requirement of the particular license. So they can take the test licenses, and on the basis of test license, they can make the drug for the clinical trials. For import, for sale and distribution, import and registration, I told you. For import of the drug from other country, they need to take the licenses. And for import, for examination test analysis, if you are a manufacturer, you are manufacturing some XYZ drug and you want to compare your drug with the imported drug, so that particular drug can be imported into the test and licenses. You need no need to have the import licenses. So these type of licenses we have. So what are the regulatory provisions for the inspections? As I told you that for the manufacturing unit, if you're going to start it, you need to go for the inspection procedures. So in recently amended GSR, that is a gazette notification 1337, so now the inspection is taking care jointly. For example, the inspector from the central government as well as the inspector from the state government usually come to the premises, they inspect the premises and submit the report to the licensing authority. On the basis of the report finding, the licensing authority issue the licenses or issue the queries, whatever the observation is there. Joint inspection is there for the biologicals like LVPs, large volume parental, vaccines, blood banks, and RDN products. Inspections of the compliance verification, investigation, and complaint, they can be announced inspection and unannounced inspection is there. Provisions for the inspections of overseas manufacturers, if somebody want to take the medicines from China, so we are going to the China for the inspections also, and in recent year we have blacklisted many companies in China, and we have started this practice after 2010 only. Then joint inspection with respect to the WHO GMP certification, if you want to export the product, so there is 197 countries who is WHO members countries, so they are accepting the WHO certificate issued by the respective country's regulatory authority. So for export of the drug, so they need the WHO certification. That WHO certification is issued by the regulatory authorities. For that, the joint inspection is required. Provisions of the inspection of overseas manufacturing, and this is already told you, inspection of the written confirmation. Written confirmation is basically a certification program for export of active pharmaceutical product to European countries. So for that also, need to inspect the premises. Inspection of clinical trial site, ethics committee, BAB center, and central inspection for the biological and clinical trial. Then there is a regulatory provision for the penalties, on which cases we are giving the penalties, and penalties given by the only court of law. So we have just filed the case to the before the honorable court, and the court decide the penalty. It is written how much penalties is to be given to that particular culprits. So there is a one penalty, lifetime imprisonment. So this is amended in 2009 or 10, that lifetime imprisonment, if you can prove that in the court of law that that particular drug can harm to the patient and can kill the patient, so it's a life threatening drug, so you can apply for the lifetime imprisonment. So if there is a spurious drug, adulterated drug, and not of standard quality, so you can approach for the lifetime imprisonment. So not of standard quality and misbranded drug, so there is a provision of the prosecution. So after you can file the prosecution to the court. If there is a without license or not according with the condition of the license, so there is a provision of penalties. Drug prohibited by the central government, as I told you that the drug banning is issued by the central government, and after issuing of the banning, if that drug is available in the market, so you can prosecute that person. For non-disclosure of the name of the manufacturer means if you find some spurious or some, you know, adulterated drug into the market, so you can ask that particular person from where you can purchase that. If they are unable to disclose that, so you can give the penalties or you can prosecute that. For keeping, not keeping the document, for not keeping the document, it is eligible, applicable for the sale premises as well as the manufacturing premises also. Suspension and cancellation of the permission is there. This is kind of the penalty which is taken care of by the licensing authority, and debarment of the person involved into the committee. So we are blacklisting all the many manufacturers to submit the application for further, you know, further submission for further approval of the drug. So this is a kind of penalty. So this is the last section of my slide, that is a glimpse of clinical new drug clinical trial. You know, this rule is very vast, very vast. But I have just made this slide just to understand by the student perspective as well as the faculty member perspective who are, you know, very much interested in the research work. So the slide is very concise and very consolidated. So what is scope of the new drug clinical trial? Because there is a new drug coming one by one very fastly, because when I joined this department in 2009, I was just know that I have seen that also there is a 4 to 5 application of the new drug. But nowadays there is a plenty of new drugs coming into the market just because of, you know, India is upgrading in the pharmaceutical company, pharmaceutical sector. So there is a need of the making of the new clinical trial rule to just compete or come as the level of the international platform. So we have just made this new drug clinical trial rule. So basically, it's a scope of for the clinical trial, BAB studies, regulations, and the biomedical health research. So definition of the new drug, we have included the definition of the new drug. Previously, it was mentioned only the new drug, which has come first time into the India. But now there is a different definitions of the new drug. Now we have incorporated the living modified organism, monoclonal antibodies, and other genes, stem cell therapeutic products, xenografts, as well as vaccines, RDNA products, we have in this. So there is a different definitions in new drug clinical trial. You can Google it out very easily. It is available in the Google. That definition of the academic clinical trial is added in this bioavailability study, bioequivalence study, biomedical and health research, pharmacovigilance, post-trial access, similar biological and new drug. So these definition is added in the new drug clinical trial. So if we talk about the clinical trial or BAB studies of the new drug clinical investigation new drug, so what this new rule says that if anybody is applied for the clinical trial and want to manufacture and the drug is discovered in India, so within 30 working days we need to just complete the file. If there is no communication from the regulatory point of view, if there is any no lacuna in the file, so it is deemed to be, you know, found approved. So this type of new strategy we came up because this was also gave the transparency as well as just to avoid the tendency of the files burden into the department. So if in case of the clinical trial of new drug which is already approved in the market application, so it should be disposed of in 90 working days. Post trial access, this is one of the very beautiful and the major concern of the clinical trial, because what happens sometime you are enrolled in the clinical trial, you are getting a medicine and the person is also benefiting the medicine. But after the trial over, then what person should get this medicine in continuous manner so that they can be rid of this particular disease. So in previously what happened when the clinical trial is over, so persons was not getting the medicine, so that harm the health of the person. So we have just incorporated the post trial access of the new drug. even after the completion of the clinical trial, if investigator says that it is benefiting that particular person and they should know, they should get the medicine, so they will get the medicine with the approval of the licensing authority in free of cost till the disease is he or she rid of the disease. So this type of rule we have just incorporated for the benefit of academic clinical trial. Previously, if anybody knows from the faculties that academic clinical trial, we have one line that only the drug which is already available in the market can go for the clinical trial. So we have just amended that for any academic research, if you want to research for any new indication, any new route of administration of dosage form which is approved in the drug, which is already approved by the FDA. So you can go for the ethics committee. If ethics committee approve, you need to come to the licensing authority, because licensing authority is something a very long procedure. So you just get the approval from ethics committee, you can go ahead for your research purpose. So this type of relaxation is given in the academic trial. Then compensation clause is added in the rule. If anybody get hurt during the clinical trial, gravians hurt or any type of the hurt due to the drug intake, so they will get the compensation. There is a committee in the in our office in Delhi, so they are calculating. There is a calculation. There is a calculating with the age as well as the dependency of the other family member on that particular person. So we are just decided the compensation, and company, the sponsor who is just conducting the clinical trial, must give that particular amount to the person who is enrolled in the clinical trial. Import and manufacture of the new drug, as I told that import license is required, so you need to complete the file in the 90 working days. And accelerated approval is required if there is any emergency use, as in case of the vaccine Sputnik or any other drug related to the COVID-19, like favipiravir, remdesivir, we did this, and there is a very expedient approvals of the medicines. Waiver of the local clinical trial. This is also taking care by the central licensing authority. If the drug is coming from developed country, so we can give the waiver of the clinical trial, because safety and efficacy is already been established, and that is approved in that particular developed country. And if there is a provision of the global clinical trial also, two types of clinical trial is going on: the clinical trial for the manufacturing in India and the clinical trial for the study purpose. Globally it is going on. So if the India is the part of the global clinical trial, and that particular company is again coming to the India for the approval of the manufacturing or approval of the drug, so we can waive off the local clinical trial. So on the basis of the data submitted in the global clinical trial, so we can accept the study data and we can approve the drug. So if there is no scientifically evidence that any gene enzyme of particular Indian species is involved in the metabolism of the drug, so we can also waive off the local clinical trial. So there is a two provision in local waiver of the local clinical trial. First, we can give the permission of the phase 4 clinical trial. Okay, the local clinical trial may be waiver, but phase 4 clinical trial you must carry it out, and you can come into the market with the approval of the drug and can sold to the drug into market. But phase 4 clinical trial must be done with a large population. And another, if you have obtained that the data is very much clear and there is no such local waiver of the clinical trial is required, or there is any pandemic situation like COVID-19 or any other drug which is not available for the disease, any orphan drug, so you can give the local clinical trial as well as the phase 4 clinical. Disease like H1N1, hepatitis C, COVID-19, if multiple resistance tuberculosis. So this type of disease, if the drug related to this type of disease is available, so the local clinical trial can be given. So in case of the remdesivir, so there is no clinical trial in India of remdesivir in India. So I have just taken the one example of the favipiravir, how we have given the approval during this pandemic situation of favipiravir. Suppose the manufacturing unit in Baddi, R&D center in Nasik, Pune, and API unit in Ankleshwar, Gujarat. So how we did the favipiravir? Because what normal condition says that the R&D will generate the data, and then for R&D, the data will be transferred to the manufacturing unit. In manufacturing unit, there is a scale-up batches. After, because R&D batches are very small, then the in manufacturing unit there should be the commercial size batches, scale-up batches, and another phase is the API, the active pharmaceutical ingredient site that will manufacture as well as the same process. The R&D will manufacture the API batches, scale-up batches will be manufactured in API. API will get the license separately, and then the API will come to the manufacturing unit. Then the manufacturer they will manufacture the batches at commercial scale batch. Then they will generate the data, submit to DCGI, and the DCGI will see the data, whether they're given the permission to the clinical or whether directly to the for the manufacturing of the drug. So these long processes are going to take in the normal condition. But in pandemic condition, what we did, the parallel inspection we did. The one team is went to the Baddi unit, one team is went to the Pune unit, and one team is went to the Nasik unit, and one team in API unit. So there is a very reduce of the time of the inspection. Simultaneously, all the team did the inspections, generate the report. On the same day, the report is forwarded to the DCGI. DCGI has scrutinized the report and then come to the conclusion that no favipiravir can be given on the basis of clinical trial permission can be given to the favipiravir. In the favipiravir case, we have given that directly phase 3 clinical trial permission. After the phase 3 clinical trial permission, within 2 to 3 days, when they submitted the data, we have given the permission to the manufacturer to manufacture the favipiravir. And the first manufacturer is the Glenmark. We all know that Faviblu is a brand name of Glenmark. So in IVD kits, you have seen in news also, in advertisement also, there is a lot of IVD kits. IVD kits are the for the testing of the COVID-19. That can be the antibody kit, that can be the antigen kit. If you have seen the if anybody have go through the COVID-19 testing, so there are the two type of testing, RT-PCR and RAT testing, RAT, rapid antigen testing. So these testing is done by the IVD kit. So how we give the permission to the IVD kit? If we see the regular system, so firstly they are going to take the test license. Then test license, they manufacture the test batches. Test batches evaluated, submitted the data. Then there is a requirement of submission of the data. And time is 45 days of all the files. So within 45 days, we will scrutinize the file, then generate the queries. The queries will be replied by the manufacturer. And then that queries is scrutinized by again the office. And if there is again query and not satisfied with the query submitted by the manufacturer, again we issue the query. There is a series of the query, and then after completion of the queries, series of the queries, then there is inspection, report preparation, submission, forwarding to DCGI, then approval. So it takes around 3 to 4 months. But in the case of the pandemic situation, what we did, we are issuing the test license directly. We are just taking the data, and they are submitting the data after taking the test license, scrutinized within 3 to 4 days. We have target that in pandemic situation, if the file is related to the pandemic product, so we will scrutinize within 3 to 4 days. Then parallel inspection. Okay, if you want to scrutinize the file and issuing the query by the officer who is scrutinizing, you can do your own work, but simultaneously we will proceeding for the inspection also to see the GMP, good manufacturing practices. So queries portion is something different, and the inspection is parallelly going on. So this reduces the time, and then the inspection report is submitted to the manufacturing unit, and just taking the CAPA, the corrective action, if there is any observation, for example, 4 to 5 or 10 observation is there in the manufacturing unit. So we are asking for the corrective action. They are submitting the corrective action. Simultaneously, we are issuing to the, we are forwarding the inspection report to the DCGI also. And then DCGI, on the basis of the inspection reports as well as the corrective action, they are issuing the approvals. So these are related to the some examples related to the pandemic. So there is one another provision, very good provisions in the new drug clinical trial, that the manufacturing of the unapproved drug. This slide is not related to the students, but not related to the faculty members. This slide I have added just to brief or giving the information as a layman that these type of provisions are also in, you know, act, and you can explore anytime. For example, if there is any unapproved drug, not approved in India, but if there is a disease and the patient is badly required that particular drug related to that particular disease. So the patient can directly approach to the manufacturer, and on the basis of the quantity base, for example, if you need the 100 doses, so on the basis of the patient request or the patient legal hire request, they can approach to the licensing authority directly, and without clinical trial, without any submission of the data, the quantity based drug can be manufactured by the pharmaceutical firm and issued to the patient directly. So this is only the information. If this type of situation have or you may have in future, so you can approach like this also. So if drug is not available, you can directly approach to the manufacturer to avail for the availability of drug, and very very easily the license is available for that particular drug. But it's for the some, you know, orphan diseases, very rare diseases. So, you know, permissions, we have written that the permission will be given in the 90 days, but not 90 days. We are giving the permission within 10 to 15 days for that particular situation. So this is all about my slide. And I just want to end the slide with some one beautiful quote. Is duniya mein sab kuch bhi karna asambhav nahi hai. Hum wo sab kar sakte hain jo hum soch sakte hain, aur hum wo sab soch sakte hain jo humne aaj tak nahi socha. So be positive and be safe. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful and insightful presentation. I'm very sure that the students must have benefited from it in every way possible. It was an honor for us to able such a knowledgeable presentation. It's really, really, from the depth of my heart, I'm saying this. And the presentation clearly highlighted a lot of things that I guess all the students and the faculty members should be aware of, like the involvement of Ministry of Family and Health Welfare, the other ministries that are also involved in the clinical trials and all phases of the pharmaceuticals, which maybe the people are not really aware because they're only aware of like only the family and health welfare ministries involved. So that was a quite important point, I think so. And apart from that, we were also told about the regulatory system of India, like the involvement of Central Drug Standard Control Organization, CDSCO, how the central government is involved, like how the state government is involved, and how the licensing of vaccines of other drugs and all the blood banks, etc., is obtained, how the drugs are banned, what are the conditions and what are the requirements. Then we also got a detailed info about the types of licenses, and that was also very insightful, I think so. Like all the kinds of licenses for manufacturing, for wholesale and retail, for the examination and test analysis, for the how the clinical trials have to be held, for how the drug has to be imported and, you know, for sale and for distribution of the drugs. Many of these things were quite insightful. Then what was regulatory provision for inspection of the established manufacturing companies, then for how the penalties imposed, then about the new drug clinical trials also. That was also quite interesting, I must say. Then how the clinical trials are waived in case like there is a drug coming from a developed country where it has already been approved, but not here in India. So how can we import it and how can we use it? That was also quite new for me, I think so. And how the phase 4 clinical trials are relaxed, what is the provision, what are the conditions that have to be followed, and how favipiravir was, you know, you can say qualified as a drug to be used in COVID, the entire thing, the entire procedure, that was quite good. Then also about the kits that have been made available during COVID, and in such a short time, that was quite good. I must say that the rapid antigen testing, the RT-PCR testing, everything has been very helpful during the COVID and for the people and for the patients also. Then the last thing that you mentioned about was permission to manufacture the unapproved new drugs. That was also quite, I think I wasn't aware of that, I have to say. Like if a patient needs a drug and it has not been authorized in India, but it still can be given on special request. So that was quite a new thing for me, I must say. Then thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful presentation, I have to say.
Thank you so much.
Before moving on to the students, I would like to ask you the first question myself, which is, I have to ask him. Like, it was just, please tell us about the difference between the first and the second COVID wave. Like, what was the difference? How would the virus change or whatever you are aware of?
Actually, first and second wave differences always told by the ICMR as well as the AIIMS. So they too, institute is taking care, because on the basis of the gene changes in the viruses, you know, virus is having a quality to change its gene sequences regularly. We know that. So on the basis of that, they announce, and they just got the findings from the patient testing. And this type of sequence is present. Okay, this is already in India, but this is a new sequences. This was first reported in that particular country. So they are giving the name from South Africa, from African regions. So these type of naming they are giving. So on the basis of the manipulation of the gene sequences by the virus, they are just a mutation, we can say. On the basis of the mutation, they are giving the name. This is a first wave, and now there is a new sequence. This is a second wave, and then maybe the third wave. As well as they have also differentiated the first wave and second wave on the basis of the age group. First wave, if you see, the maximum the older ages was, you know, infected. But the second wave, if you say the mediocre people, like 18 to 45 age are infected more, just because of they are the earning member of the families and they are going outside, so there is a chances of the infection, more infection to that particular age. So they are giving the second wave name. Now it is expected that the children is going to be affected in the third wave. This is all statistical analysis and on the basis of the data available in all over world. So this can be happen and cannot be happen.
Yes, sir. I think that's right. That's true. That the second wave has been very devastating for everyone. I have to say, but we hope that this won't repeat in future. Now moving on to the students, I would like to request the students if they have any questions.
Very good afternoon, sir. So my question is, sir, do you think that the election that were held and the festival that were celebrated, when to some extent people got carried away and forgot about the pandemic, were responsible for the increase of COVID-19?
Oh my God, this is a very controversial question for me. Being a government employee, I cannot comment on the election procedure, but I can say that wherever there is a gathering, and if there is no safety measures, so it will increase the COVID-19. We know that the only the social distance and the masking procedure is the only way to rid of this COVID-19. So you need to avoid the gathering. So I don't know what happened in the election procedure in West Bengal and other state, but if there is a gathering without safety procedure, so there must be the reason of the increase of the COVID-19. But we cannot blame directly to the, you know, government agency on election procedure. We need to blame ourselves also, the public. Public need to aware of all this situation, and no need to panic in this situation, and, you know, no need to react with respect to their egos, that no, I cannot be infected, I am immune. And if anybody, you know, already infected by the COVID-19, they are more careless about the situation which is going on. I have seen that personally. So if you have been infected in the COVID-19, it doesn't mean that you cannot infected again by the COVID-19. It will be the more dangerous then if you get infection. So just don't behave like a carelessness. Just keeping mask with you, keeping sanitizer with you, and the social distance is the only solution for this, rid of this COVID-19.
Thank you, sir, for your answer.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I want to ask, sir, do you think that there will be a third wave of COVID? And if yes, then how should we prepare for that?
It is expecting, on the basis of the statistical analysis, as I have already told, the third wave is going to come within a month or after a month. I again saying that social distancing, avoid going outside, just keep hygiene condition, wash your hand regularly, whenever you are touching the surface, just clean your, sanitize your hand. Don't touch your nose, mouth and eyes before sanitization. So you can keep yourself safe, I am telling you. No need to panic it. This is a simple flu, you can say that. But you have to maintain the social distances and sanitization procedure with yourself.
Next question, please.
Sir, can you please tell us that who is most at risk of severe illness from the third wave of
COVID-19? This cannot be judged. This is only a prediction that the third wave of the COVID-19 is for the children only. But this is a prediction only. So no need to come in the conclusion. Let's see in the future. Maybe the COVID-19 will not come in the picture if you just maintain the social distancing, and we will just follow all the safety procedures as issued by the government guidelines. So don't come to the conclusion. Actually, that particular behavior coming into the conclusion is making a panic in the general public. Don't come into the conclusion, don't be panicked, just follow the safety procedure. I'm telling you, nothing will happen to anybody.
Okay, thank you, sir, for answering my question.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question is, are there any long-term effects of COVID-19 as per the present patient's report and data? Even after the patients recover from the COVID, what are the complications that occur?
Yes, that's a very good question, actually. You are asking a right question to the wrong person. Because it should be clarity should be given by some doctors and all that. But as far as my knowledge, that the COVID-19 is not so much difficult to handle with the COVID-19 situation, but post-COVID situation is very much dangerous. What I feel personally, there is a very much cases of cardiac arrest after COVID-19. So when you are infected by the COVID-19, just take care of yourself. Should be in the good diet, and should be a regular monitor yourself by all the tests available in the market. So cardiac arrest cases I have seen very much in there. And recently you have listened about the black fungus. So black fungus is another post COVID reactions. Just because of the oxygen mask and all that. So we are only hearing all this news only. There is no particular data how black fungus is spreading and all that. So you need to be just conscious post COVID, I think so.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for clearing out my question.
Thank you.
Very good afternoon, sir. So my question is very simple but so important. Can you please tell us what is the difference between quarantine and isolation?
What do you think about the difference, isolation and quarantine? I think both are same. You are going to isolate yourself while quarantine. both are mostly same. Quarantine and isolation, basically you need to be isolate yourself when you are getting infected. And you need to be quarantined yourself to see whether it is infection is going to be increased or not. So this is a very thin line difference is there. Isolation means you need to be separate yourself from the general public or your family members and all that. And the quarantine means you are in an initial phase, or you may be a chance of the infection. So you must be keep in a quarantine area while testing. If you got tested by RT-PCR, so till the time the result will come, so you need to be kept yourself in a quarantine.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Very good afternoon, sir. So my question is, which vaccine do you think is best for COVID-19? Should people really choose the option they have?
I was expecting this question in the seminar, actually. Don't come in any rumors. All vaccines are very good, and safety and efficacy data is available with the regulatory authority, and whatever is available when you are going for the vaccination, so just do and take the vaccine. Don't worry about it. Vaccinated with anyone, all vaccines are good and efficient.
Thank you, sir.
don't come in the judgment that this is a good, this is a bad and all that, which is a rumor going in the market. All vaccines are good. Safety and efficacy data is available with all vaccines. All are safe and good enough.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ji.
Okay. Good afternoon, sir. So my question is, are antibiotics like remdesivir and doxycycline effective in preventing COVID-19?
Actually, remdesivir is not the antibiotic, it's an antiviral, and doxycycline is the antibiotic basically. Remdesivir is approved for the COVID-19 for for the mild COVID-19, not the severe COVID-19. Recently, what we have seen that there is a huge and cry of the remdesivir in whole over the country, especially in Delhi area. If you have seen that, remdesivir is not the Ramban, as told by the Dr. Guleria also by in AIIMS. Remdesivir is only approved for the mild, moderate to mild COVID-19. But anyhow, if there is no medication, the doctor has tried for the remdesivir also, and the patient get benefited also by this using remdesivir also. But remdesivir is not the only disease. First thing is that, so don't come in panic. If you don't have an remdesivir and you are infected by the COVID-19, no need to be panicked. There is another medication like doxycycline. You say that it's an antibiotic. It's a one of the medications you can rid of the infections, another infection caused during the COVID-19. So COVID-19 is flu. So there is a remdesivir is available. You can take remdesivir, or Fabiflu is available. You can take Fabiflu. So mainly the steroid is the only option for the remdesivir, which we have observed in during these years. But steroid is also, you know, having a side effect. So there is a procedure of taking a steroid. No need to take the steroid by your own self. So there is a, you know, different dosage regimen. If you have studied in pharmacology and all that, so you cannot take starting the steroid in the higher dose. There is a type of dosage regimen you need to follow for the steroid.
Thank you.
Very good afternoon, sir. Sir, my question is, how do you think COVID has impacted the clinical research domain?
COVID has impacted not only the clinical research domain, but everybody. In every, you know, every work is infected by the COVID-19. As you know that the research domain, if you talk about, yes, it is infected. It is affected by the way that the person is not going continuously to their work to continue their research. Some of the research, you know, that required the continuous attention in the laboratory. If there is any lockdown, you are not going to the laboratory. So your research, I think 2 to 3 years of continuous research going vain. You need to start from the A. So that type of the effect happened in the COVID-19. So COVID-19 has affected, you know, very much in our life, the whole life. But we need to rid of this. Don't be panic, and we need to rid of this, and we will definitely do. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for clearing my query.
Sir, I have one more question. Sir, do you think the process in developing the vaccine for SARS-CoV and the treatment of COVID-19 is disrupting many upcoming or ongoing clinical trials of other diseases around the globe?
Sir, I'll repeat the question. She just asked that, right now the focus is on developing vaccines for SARS-CoV-2 and for the treatment of COVID-19. Like, how is it affecting the other diseases' clinical trials?
No, it is not impacted in the other, disease of the clinical trial. No doubt, for starting the clinical trial, or for the clinical trial, you need to have a patient. You need to have, centers for the clinical trial that need to be separate from the COVID-19 patients. No doubt, there is a risk of the COVID-19 when the patient is going to the hospital and taking the medication in the clinical trial. No doubt, when there is a lockdown, there is a very restriction to moving to the hospitals while going to take the dose that is fixed in the protocol during the clinical trial of other diseases. That particular day, the people are afraid of going outside and moving to the hospitals for taking the doses. So these type of consideration has been taken by the Drug Controller General India, and we have one meeting with all the, you know, stakeholders also. There is a provision of the amendment of the protocols with the scientific justifications. We have just accepted that justification also. There is a scientific committee who have seen all these scenarios. Amendment of the protocol has been approved. And if there is any issues related to the study or restart of the study is required, so we have given the permission in the same clinical trial NOCs. This type of steps we have taken. Very good question you have asked, Arya. Thank you.
I believe that's all the questions and queries we have, sir. And thank you so much for clearing out all the queries that we had. It was indeed a lovely, insightful, knowledgeable and successful webinar, I have to say. We have clearly understood as to how COVID-19, this pandemic, has drastically affected us, our society, our medical health system, the entire society and also the earth. We all need to continue monitoring and assessing the situation. Assess if the risk of a pandemic is increasing. We have to still maintain social distancing. We have to follow all the protocols and norms that have been already set. At the individual level, we should always consider the risk of direct communication, maintain individual hygiene and personal protection. As soon as possible, get vaccinated at the nearest available centers. I would like to request Manju ma'am to please give the vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. Here, I take the opportunity to propose a vote of thanks to our chief guest for today's speaker, Mr. Sushant Sharma, Assistant Drug Controller of India, respected Vice Chancellor, sir, Pro Vice Chancellor, sir, Registrar, sir, Deans and Directors of other departments of Sri Ram Swarup Memorial University. I, on behalf of the Institute, extend a hearty vote of thanks to all the delegates of the webinar for their presence and contribution to make this webinar exemplary. I extend my heartfelt gratitude and thanks to our respected chief guest, Mr. Sushant Sharma, to take out from his busy schedule, to take out the time from his busy schedule to grace the event. And thank you for enlightening, inspiring and encouraging us with your words and knowledge of the parts and functions of the CDSCO, types of licenses, penalties, compensation, approval of the drug, and so on this occasion. And I would like to thank to all the faculty members for being a support system, and also like to thank all the students for being a part of this webinar. And thank you, Sarah, for our organizing webinar in such a short time. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much, and I must say it's a very active and active participation by the student. I am very happy to see that, and hope so some of the student I will see in my department after completion of BPharm. Thank you so much, and all the best, all of you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.